Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our panel, which is titled The Global Pandemic of 2020 to 22 Historical Contexts and Current Perspectives. My name is Bruce Janz. I'm the co-director of the Center for Humanities and Digital Research, who is the sponsor for this, this panel today. The center has been in operation since 2007, and we're a center for humanities research within the College of Arts and Humanities. We have partnerships across the university with other universities and with community groups in Florida and beyond. We have a special focus on the digital humanities, but we're interested in any way that we can include humanities and arts perspectives in issues of contemporary interest. And this panel's topic today is certainly one of those. This panel was generously sponsored by the Florida Humanities Council. We applied for a grant under the line Greater Good Humanities in Academia, and in collaboration with the National Endowment of the Humanities, we were able to get that grant. That grant line focuses on exploring what it means to be human, allowing us to better understand and share our experiences, values, and dreams. And so we thought that what more apt topic could we have than what we've all been through over the last 2 years and continuing. Many have felt great pain through all of this, and all of us have had to change our daily habits and our ways of associating and our ways of communicating through all of this. I would like to sincerely thank you for being part of this today, for those of you who are with us in person, and also those of you who are with us virtually online. This promises to be a great panel. I would like to introduce my co-director, Dr. Mark Kamrath, who will tell you more about the panel, the topic of the panel itself. Dr. Kamrath.
Thank you, Bruce. Welcome. Let me begin by also thanking Florida Humanities for funding this interdisciplinary panel as part of its Greater Good Humanities and Academia public programming, and by thanking our partners, Rollins College, Seminole State College, Valencia College, Stetson University, Lake Sumter College, Bethune-Cookman University, Daytona State College, and UCF Libraries for their participation. I'd also like to thank Dr. Raul Pino and the Orange County Public Health Department for their public health policy guidance these past 2 years, and President Cartwright, Provost Johnson, and many others at UCF for implementing those policies to the best of their ability to protect faculty, students, and staff. Since COVID-19 has impacted the world like no other event in the last 100 years, this panel explores the historical context of infectious disease in America, beginning with the yellow fever of 1793 and the Spanish flu of 1918 and 19, before examining the current state of the COVID-19 pandemic in Florida and around the world. It also looks critically at various medical and social debates related to public health policy and patient rights. Before I introduce our panelists, I want to note that there will be a question and answer session after the presentations, that those who are attending the panel virtually using Zoom may submit questions by using the Q&A option. Attendees can click on the Q&A button in their Zoom toolbar and enter their questions. If you could please indicate that you have a question, that will help us collect them more easily. We'll be taking room questions first and then virtual ones. Our first speaker, Professor Amy Foster, is an associate professor of history at the University of Central Florida. Her research and teaching interests include the history of medicine, science and technology, and the history of the U.S. space program. Her presentation is entitled, An American Plague, the Social Crisis of the 1793 Yellow Fever Epidemic in Philadelphia. Our next speaker, Dr. Luciana Garbeo, is a jointly appointed assistant professor at the Departments of Philosophy and Medical Education at the University of Central Florida. She is the Director of Ethics and Medical Humanities Longitudinal Curriculum Theme for the College of Medicine at UCF, and the Director of Ethics Research Group for the Society of Medical Decision Making. Her research interests include the study of the modeling and representation of medical knowledge, medical reasoning, and the ethical management of uncertainty for medical decision-making. Her presentation is entitled Lessons from the Spanish Flu Pandemics in Three Waves, Understanding the Past and the Present. Our third speaker, Professor Sarah Singer, is an assistant professor in the Department of English at the University of Central Florida. Her work investigates how people communicate about ambiguous and controversial health conditions, such as Lyme disease and long COVID. Her presentation is entitled Understanding Misunderstandings, Patients as Researchers in the COVID-19 Pandemic. Our last speaker, who's not quite here yet, Dr. Elena Cyrus, is an assistant professor in the Department of Population Health Sciences, College of Medicine, University of Central Florida. She's an infectious disease epidemiologist with research experience in sub-Saharan Africa, Southeast Asia, and the Latin American and Caribbean region. Her research focuses on investigating social determinants of health, contributing toward health inequities among vulnerable populations globally. Her presentation is entitled COVID-19 Updates, Past, Current, and Future Trajectories. Thank you.
All right, there we go. The mic's on. All right. Oop, back. You forwarded it for me. There we go. So you may be wondering why a historian was invited to participate in a panel on the global pandemic of 2020 to 2022. Do we have enough historical perspective on events of the past 2 years to really be able to offer much insight at this point? Perhaps even more curious is why a speaker for this panel should talk about an epidemic that plagued a single city instead of a pandemic like the Black Death in the mid-14th century, or why we should discuss events that ended nearly 230 years ago. I refer to this epidemic in the title of my talk as a social crisis, and I think that is where we can look back on the 1793 yellow fever case and draw some real comparisons to the current pandemic. While we could find similar themes between the COVID pandemic and the flu pandemic from a century ago, what strikes me about this much more contained and shorter lived epidemic is that it reminds us that disease, even ones caused by the smallest viruses, can wreak havoc and leave an indelible mark on a community and a society. So let's begin our story. On August 19, 1793, Dr. Benjamin Rush, arguably the most well-known physician in the young United States and a signer of the Declaration of Independence, left his home on Walnut Street, down at the bottom, to attend a patient living on Water Street near the docks along the Delaware River. And that literally is the path he took. I don't know why. The patient, 33-year-old Catherine Lemaigre, the wife of a French merchant, was dying. Her fever raged. The best Dr. Rush could do was bleed her, essentially opening a vein with a lancet. I think I have a picture of the lancet. Nope, I don't. And collecting enough blood into a small bowl to be deemed therapeutic. Yet this wasn't the first patient Rush had attended. In the previous 2 weeks, Rush had been called to the bedside of 9 other people, 5 of them who died. While these patients were just appearing that August, these symptoms were not unfamiliar. There had been a memorable outbreak in the city in 1762 when Rush was still an apprentice. So when he saw the symptoms again in 1793, he concluded that the disease was bilious remitting yellow fever. Like COVID-19, and that is the yellow fever virus, so it looks kind of similar. Like COVID-19, yellow fever is a virus, but unlike COVID, which attacks the respiratory system, yellow fever is a hemorrhagic disease like Ebola. The illness starts with a fever that can be very high, up to 104 degrees. After that, the patient's skin and the whites of their eyes take on a yellowish appearance, which is from damage to the patient's liver causing jaundice. The patient may still recover at this point, and many did. But once the internal hemorrhaging began, which was visible as purple bruising on the skin and bleeding from the nose and gums, the prognosis grew dire. The final symptom was black vomit, vomit that appeared to have used coffee grounds in it, but was actually blood that had been broken down by the stomach acids. Death followed quickly after that. Also, unlike COVID, which is spread through aerosol and droplet transmission from person to person, making it reasonably possible to spread the disease, yellow fever does not spread so easily. But there's still some comparisons. The novel coronavirus was unknown to scientists and physicians. They were able to make some early assumptions because it's part of the SARS family of viruses. But the questions at the start of the pandemic included how the virus was transmitted and ultimately just how infectious and deadly was this new disease. Those questions led to more personally motivated ones. How do I avoid getting sick? And what will happen if I do get sick? Underlying all these questions is the very powerful emotion of fear, which drives the panic, sense of crisis, and unfortunately the tendency to place blame on others and dominates an epidemic or pandemic situation. But in 1793, physicians' understanding of how disease generally and yellow fever specifically spread was still a guessing game. Oh, yep, there we go. It wasn't until 1900 when it was finally determined that yellow fever was spread through the bite of the Aedes aegypti mosquito, which carried the contaminated blood from one person to another. That discovery was made by U.S. Army surgeon Walter Reed and his team making up the Yellow Fever Commission stationed in Cuba during the Spanish-American War. Understanding the mosquito's part in the spread of yellow fever also explains why the disease disappeared from Philadelphia in November after the long hot summer was finally replaced by a late frost. But Rush and other members of the College of Physicians didn't know this about yellow fever. In fact, they had conflicting theories about what caused the disease, and that had much to do with limited knowledge of infectious disease in the 18th century. It wasn't until German physician Robert Koch isolated the anthrax bacillus in 1876, and then French chemist Louis Pasteur developed a vaccine for anthrax in 1881 that solidified the argument that microorganisms cause disease. And I'll say at this point, even American physicians at this point were not buying into germ theory. It takes really until the early 20th century for the majority of American physicians to get on board with that idea. But that understanding was nearly a century after the epidemic faced by Philadelphians had ended. The two dominant theories about yellow fever in 1793 were the miasma and contagion theories. Benjamin Rush supported the miasma theory, and he attended patients in the vicinity of Water Street, and it was clear to him that their close proximities to each other was key to the disease's spread. But instead of considering person-to-person transmission, he believed that noxious smells, or miasmas, which means bad air in Latin, caused the disease. As it happened, a cargo ship, Amelia, had arrived from Santo Domingo, present-day Haiti, with a large shipment of coffee beans that had rotted on the journey. With no way to sell the product, the crew dumped the putrefying cargo on the wharf just one block from Water Street and Dr. Rush's patients. Consistent with his belief in the miasma theory, Rush petitioned the mayor, Matthew Clarkson, to rid the filth from the streets of Philadelphia as the only way to stop the disease from spreading. But the contagion theory supported by Rush's fellow physician William Curry, was equally persuasive. More than 2 weeks before Rush recognized the sickness of yellow fever, on August 3rd, in Richard Denny's lodging house on Water Street, three people were sick with fever. Within 5 days, they were dead, along with three others, including Denny and his wife, and two people living next door. Two of the victims were French sailors. It's at this point where our story makes a more international turn, as we've witnessed with COVID-19. In August 1791, the slaves of the West Indian island of Santo Domingo, which was a French colony, started a revolution against their owners. The war was devastating, continuing until 1804, when the Haitian people fully gained their independence. But the free blacks, slaves, the French, and eventually British soldiers involved in the fighting also faced yellow fever, which was a constant threat on the island because of the warm, humid climate. Even though the rebellion waged on, by July 1793, French citizens, or French residents of the island, along with their black household slaves and servants, fled to the United States Capitol, which at the time was Philadelphia. In total, around 2,000 refugees arrived in the city, and shortly thereafter, Philadelphians began dying of yellow fever. The connection between the arrival of the refugees and the appearance of the disease was difficult to challenge. As the nation's capital, and this is Independence Hall, where the Declaration of Independence was signed, but the building on the right is actually where Congress met until the Congressional Hall was built in Washington, D.C. So as the nation's capital, Philadelphia was home to all the top political figures, and they were growing more divided in their political views, whether to support a Federalist agenda, which was against French anarchy, or a Republican agenda, which feared an English monarchy. Then yellow fever was thrown into the mix. Miasma theory suggested there was something inherent in the United States that was unclean and dangerous, which was a bitter pill to swallow. Contagion theory, on the other hand, supported the belief that others, specifically the French, were to blame. At some level, the fact that yellow fever already had a name made the situation less divisive. Those who supported the Federalist cause, including many physicians, supported the contagion or the importationist position. It helped to settle any fears that the land or climate of their new country was unhealthy and shifted the blame onto dirty refugees. The French refugees did get aid and support, but the fear and anxiety directed at the French was real. In comparison, when it became clear that COVID-19 was a pandemic instead of a more isolated epidemic, people began referring to the novel coronavirus as the China virus or the Wuhan virus, both of which labeled and demonized the Chinese people and culture in the same way that the Spanish people were unfairly loathed in 1918 when people started calling the H1N1 influenza virus the Spanish flu. Between March 2020 and August 2021, over 9,000 hate crimes against people of Asian or Pacific Islander descent were reported in the United States. That condemnation of entire groups of people out of fear just because of a name is the reason why in 2015, the World Health Organization began advising against giving geographical names to newly discovered pathogens. As Philadelphia succumbed to the fever, many members of the federal government, including George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, along with 19,000 others, mostly upper class, fled to the cleaner, less populated countryside. The city started the epidemic with 51,200 people. After the exodus, 31,600 remained. 29,000 were white, 2,600 were black, a mixture of free blacks and household slaves. Those figures become more relevant when we think about the COVID-19 comparison and the demographics of essential workers. Aside from healthcare workers and first responders, the essential workforce, those working at grocery stores and gas stations, as delivery drivers and garbage collectors, are not white, middle, and upper class Americans. For those lucky enough to have their work shift to remote status and not have it affect their income or job security, it meant their risk from COVID in no way compared to those who were unable to step away from their on-site work. In Philadelphia, the dominant fear was that caring for the sick, removing the dead from their homes to mass graves, and digging those graves meant putting themselves at high risk. As more members of the white community fell ill or died from the disease, those grew more desperate for help. Benjamin Rush believed that people of African descent were immune. So he turned to Absalom Jones and Richard Allen, both former slaves and religious leaders in the black community, to help organize black volunteers to nurse the sick. The hours were long and often meant sitting up with a patient overnight, and this might go on for days. As the fever's toll took its toll, the demand for blacks to nurse the sick grew. Unfortunately for all involved, Rush was wrong about black immunity. One estimate suggests that 14% of the white population contracted yellow fever, as did 11% of the black population. What is unclear, however, is how many cases went unreported. One of the lasting legacies of the 1793 epidemic is two publications. One of the country's leading printer, Matthew Carey, titled A Short Account of the Malignant Fever Lately Prevalent in Philadelphia, was released in November 1793. And Jones and Allen's narrative of the proceedings of the black people during the late awful calamity in Philadelphia in the year 1793 which first appeared on January 7, 1794. Carey's account tried to depict the devastation of the city, not just in loss of life, but the loss of morals. He wrote about family members abandoning their sick relatives to die, the ever-present sick carts taking people to the overcrowded hospital, and the hearses taking bodies to the gravesites. He also praised the efforts of Allen and Jones, but then spilled much more ink on, quote, some of the vilest of the blacks who extorted $2, $3, $4, even $5 a night, as would have been well spent for a single dollar. Some were even detected plundering the houses of the sick, end quote. Allen and Jones used their reputation to challenge Carey on many of his claims. They argued that their community members had not stolen from their patients or their families, that the racist condemnations and prejudices in the pamphlet would not be ignored, and that Benjamin Rush's argument that blacks were immune and therefore would not suffer from the disease was false. They needed the rest of Philadelphia to know that this was their epidemic as well. In the end, approximately 5,000 people died during the epidemic, almost 10% of the city's population at its start. Carey's account of the epidemic reflects an animosity towards the black community. It was not just an attack on those who served as nurses, given the high likelihood that more poor whites were doing the job than blacks, since blacks still only represented 8% of the population after so many had fled early in the epidemic. What I believe this account reflects is as much pain and loss felt at all levels of the community as it does racial tension. These emotions can trickle over into less than humanitarian actions, as was seen after the death of George Floyd in May 2020 and the resulting race riots in the Midwest. As we look back on the 1793 yellow fever epidemic, we can see similarities to our current situation. Fear, uncertainty, and the lack of information combined with real threat tend to undermine our sense of humanity and social justice. As we continue to enter what is likely to be an endemic situation with COVID-19, I hope that studying and learning from the past, including the 1793 yellow fever epidemic, can remind us of the dangers, not just from the disease, but from our own reactions. Thank you.
I'd like to start by thanking Professor Skamrath and Jens for the invitation. It's a very kind invitation to participate in this event, which I think is absolutely fundamental for us to foster collaboration among ourselves and further. So I would like to start by saying that I'm a physician and a philosopher. And I work on improving understanding the representation of scientific knowledge, and particularly in the context of making decisions. So I'm interested in making decisions under uncertainty. Did it go? All right. So this is an introduction into a way of thinking rather than a comprehensive analysis. I hope that this presentation may pique your curiosity to engage in further discussion. It is very difficult to learn when we need and not what we want to learn, right? There's a pandemic imposes itself and disrupts our priorities. Further, it requires from us a true interdisciplinary spirit in order to collaborate in understanding the past in the light of the present. In this sense, the humanities play a crucial role in bringing to us the records, the experience for making sense of those patterns that we find in the human history in order to find the responses that we can learn from the past to apply today. Yeah. Okay. So in decision making, we face as learners the challenge to learn sometimes against our own beliefs. In this situation, for managing uncertainty, we restrain ourselves to carefully consider our beliefs. So like Odysseus, who enchained himself to the mast of his ship in order to resist the sirens, the classic Iliad image, we also have to learn to be counterintuitive, because this is about learning to update our beliefs as we face an existential challenge. So in this existential process, we need to collaboratively constitute at least two lines of inquiry, I would argue. We need to develop a natural history, in the case here of Spanish flu, which provide us with an actionable scientific representation of the pandemic natural phenomena. And we need also a history of the social, scientific, and public health responses to the Spanish flu with its outcomes. Together, they help us to understand historical responses to diseases and to actually use those lessons in order to apply to various populations, which can help us to better respond to current challenges. So here's some elements for a natural history of the Spanish flu. For today, we know that the Spanish flu is really based on the influenza H1N1. They did not know that in the past. So a virus is a particular type of parasite that needs a host cell to multiply by using the cell's own machinery and the metabolism of the host. The life cycle of the virus is resumed by the ability to enter the host cell, for which it needs a key. In the case of the H1N1 is the H key, multiply itself and then leave the cell to multiply in other cells of other hosts. So this is basically the structure we have to understand of the natural cycle of the virus. Being a RNA virus, just like the coronavirus, it copies more easily. They are more fragile. They mutate more likely. So that leads for the emergence of variants. And this is actually really important, because the more it infects, the more people it infects, the more opportunity it has to actually develop those variants. So it's important, it makes a difference if we are going to allow more and more people to get infected or not, from the point of view of the emergence of variants. So the origins of the virus should be interpreted ecologically and also in the relation between species. So the hypothesis here is that infected duck and geese crossed the interspecies barrier, right? The virus crossed that barrier through mutations and proximity. So humans working very, very close to birds, and then over time, with the variations, the mutations of the virus, it developed the ability to actually enter the cells of the host. So first, we can think of this emergence of disease in a localized community. So this is an epidemic, right? So this is very important. This is the terminology we need to understand. Those things are absolutely connected, right? So imagine first the transition from animal to human. Right, so then you see that within that community, then you have in this constrained area, the emergence of the disease that's called epidemics. Now, as people move, what you have is the spread of the virus. And that's when the geographic spread, that's the widespread epidemic, is a pandemic, That's what's important to understand. And with the evolution of the mutations within the pandemic, then you're going to have the waves, right? And we suggest that the endemic state is actually when the cycle and the immunity of the population have somehow balanced it out, that what you're going to have is for every new generation and every season, you're going to have the disease spread, but just locally. So just like the seasonal flu. So then we can see the cycle, right? Endemic, pandemic, epidemic, pandemic, endemic. All right. So historically, the first documented influenza pandemic was in the 16th century. And it is interesting to see that they actually were looking at seasonality, and they were looking at the how this connected particularly to the movement of the stars. So there's like a number of reasons for that. But the Italians then, because they were thinking about the influence of the stars and the seasonality, they called the virus then influenza, right? It means influenced in Italian. So that's where it got its initial name. And they were actually considering causality. Another really important element to think of a natural history of disease here is that the Spanish flu in particular is considered the most severe pandemic in the history of the world. At least 50 million people died, and it is estimated that one-third of the population was actually infected at some time. Right. So you can see here the three waves as suggested by the CDC. And here you can see how those three waves will actually be characterized by social events that will modulate the size or the magnitude of the response. So the first wave unlocks the problem of the origins of the Spanish flu pandemics. It started as an emergent flu epidemic in Haskell County, Kansas, in January 1918. A local physician, Dr. Miner, informed the U.S. Public Health Services at the time, and it was confounded with the seasonal flu that they had. So they didn't see really a great difference, and they were not alarmed. More remarkably, this emergent flu epidemic finds a social context. The First World War effort, which through the transmission in close quarters in Camp Funston, among the soldiers, led to the first identified Spanish flu patient and influenza outbreak with 522 infected soldiers. Right. This is where we start to actually see that the idea of close quarters also was a marker for seeing how underprivileged populations were first infected than everybody else. So that's where the literature starts to talk about equity and the distribution of disease. Okay, so this is the emergency ward at Camp Funston. And you see that they were actually in very close quarters. And after that, many of them were shipped in troop ships to Europe, and that's when we have the second wave. So you see there's no second wave without the social factor of shipping the infected soldiers overseas. So the second wave was actually characterized by uneven responses to the pandemic. So the troop ships finally came back from Europe and brought now the infected soldiers. So first they went and then they spread in Europe, and from Europe it went throughout the world. And then they came back. And they came back in first initially to Boston Harbor, to the Boston Navy Yard in August 2018. So at this time, no testing was available, no knowledge of the virus, of course, no vaccine. And the only available policy was social distance, including face coverings. So here's an important historical example of the difference between societal responses and pandemic outcomes in the contrast between what happened in the return of the troops in Philadelphia versus St. Louis, right, regarding the policy of social distance. In the effort, since the war effort was in full swing, there was a request for the realization of the Liberty Bond Parade, which was a parade to sell government bonds. So Philadelphia, as opposed to St. Louis, decided to go ahead and keep the parade. And as a result, in around 6 weeks, 2,000 people were reported dead after the parade. Now, St. Louis, on the other hand, canceled the parade, closed businesses, churches, and schools, and any public gathering, and they had, as a result, an estimated number of 700 dead. So this is actually a very important case study to understand how the social context is fundamental for the severity of a pandemic. All right. Okay, so the third wave was smaller and actually coincided with the end of the World War I. So soldiers were coming back, ready to celebrate, and these celebrations actually contributed again for the spread, and then you have the third wave, right? So in addition to that, there was a clear pandemic fatigue. So people really wanted to celebrate. They couldn't take this anymore. All right. So another factor that's really important is that since medical knowledge was still feeble at the time, and the scientific medicine was then reduced to activities that were effective activities, particularly traditional medicine, such as bloodletting, was really detrimental and killed more than helped. So here there's something really important on the social history of medicine here, because the saving grace were really the nurses. The nurses actually kept people healthy because they were taking care of recovery. So the volunteers as caregivers and nurses were actually the savers as opposed to the doctors. Okay. All right. So I just want to make a mention. This is actually perhaps one of the most significant stories for me that combine natural history with social history, which is the isolation and identification of the virus only happened because the Inuit community in Alaska that has been allowing the scientific community to actually exhume the bodies of their loved ones. So the community had 80 people and 72 died. And over 10 years, they allowed the scientists to come and take samples of their loved ones. And finally, they were able to identify, sequence, and make a vaccine. This is because of community participation, the Inuit community. That's why we know, right? So I'm just going to show them that the critical role of community, right? So this is what one of the lessons that we learn. If you have a community participating in controlling the spread, then now you can go, that's what people call flattening the curve. You can flatten the curve and you can really reduce numbers. So it's an incredible impact in the life of others. Another lesson that we have to learn is that there is an inherent complexity in having to actually model endemics, epidemics, and pandemics. So you have thresholds. You have to be thinking in a complex way on how those waves, and that's why a public health is really fundamental, so that we know the impact of a community in helping to keep epidemics at bay. All right, so very, very quickly, I just want to say, here's some lessons for us to think about. One is about careful surveillance. So we actually have been losing opportunities in terms of information. So there is a crucial need to invest in public health surveillance and have effective departments of health, such as St. Louis, that work on outcomes so that we can actually know what we can do to improve. We have to access the quality of information for preventive action. So one interesting thing, the name Spanish flu is actually because Spain was neutral during the First World War, and therefore they were actually publicizing the deaths in the pandemic. So therefore, first people heard from Spanish newspapers. Now they thought that was a Spanish flu, but it wasn't. But in fact, that's what people think. Okay, so another thing is how important, how crucial is nursing and caregiving, how centering saving and recovery. So it's not an afterthought, it's actually a pillar of care in pandemics. And another thing is the relevance of the quality of scientific medicine in pandemic care. This is it's a lesson that we have from them. So in order to do first no harm, we really have to have a high standard of guidelines in scientific medicine. Okay, just to take it a little further, very important to work the interspecies barrier crossing problem. So this is what the CDC One Health platform provides us to think about environment and animals and humans and how we can actually design ecologically so that we don't infringe in their space and other way around, so that we don't have the emergence of zoonosis, right? We should be very attentive how important to keep the relationships with communities. They were the ones who gave us the access to the dead for providing without those relations with traditional communities, this wouldn't happen. The other thing is clearly, as we learned that there is a distribution, an equal distribution, we have to have health policy that's equitable so that we respect the distribution of risks, including the urbanistic planning. Okay, so with all of that, we should really be in the business of developing resources early, and this will never go away. It's just something that we have to navigate. Okay, thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you all so much for being here today. It is a pleasure. Do you mind passing the clicker?
Perfect. Sorry.
Oh, no, 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 perfect, thank you. Welcome, everyone, and thank you again so much for joining us. I'm so pleased to be here. My name is Dr. Sarah Singer, and I'm an assistant professor in the Department of English here at University of Central Florida. To increase accessibility, I invite you to follow along with this talk by scanning the QR code that is up here. In that vein, my presentation pivots to talking about our current pandemic, COVID-19. However, I sense that you were already tired of hearing about it, how people have suffered, how their lives have been irrevocably changed by illness, trauma, caregiving, and death, the changing protocols, and worst of all, what other people think about it. More than ever, it seems like there is nothing we can agree on. Relationships with our loved ones have been strained by our varying understanding of this condition, even when it seemed safe enough to gather together again in the same physical spaces. No conversation was safe, at least not in my family. President Biden assured us that the vaccine would allow us to have both safe and happy holidays this past year. As someone quipped on Twitter in response, no vaccine is strong enough to guarantee that. Members of my own family have referred to the COVID-19 pandemic as a scamdemic and a plandemic. My personal relationships with friends and family members have shifted based on their decisions about taking COVID tests, wearing masks, and isolating or not during periods of illness. As an immunocompromised, chronically ill person, I've worried about my risks, physical, mental, and interpersonal, more than at any other time in my adult life. Fortunately, as a rhetoric and technical communication scholar, hopefully I've found a few things that we can all agree on. First, everyone is unhinged. Right now, the COVID-19 pandemic has caused many of us to unmask, literally and figuratively. We can no longer hide our fear, anger, and grief, and we are sharing our feelings, sometimes screaming them, in person and on social media. Additionally, the COVID-19 pandemic has coincided with an exponential increase in misinformation on the internet, as well as major social and political shifts in the United States and across the world. People have taken it upon themselves to share emerging information, which contributes to both the rapid progress of research as well as the proliferation of dangerous misinformation. How can we follow a business as usual protocol when it feels like everything is on fire? Two, no one is trustworthy. The COVID-19 pandemic has eroded Americans' public trust in the scientific process and scientific expertise. Everyone wants our time, money, and attention. Emerging data about COVID-19 is fostering suspicion rather than excitement at the rapid pace of scientific advancement. With the rise of search engine optimization, fake reviews, and efficient marketing, it's hard to know if you need to wear a mask, let alone which one to buy on Amazon. Three, everyone has been brainwashed by the media, liberal, conservative, or otherwise. Research shows that our news feeds are optimized to only share things that align with our beliefs. So it makes sense that we virtually surround ourselves with people and information that appeal to us. It's hard to get beyond these silos. Previously, I used to tell my students that if they found 5 or more sources that shared the same information, it was likely true and could be considered a good source. This is no longer true. With new developments unfolding in real time on the 24-hour news and the unending scrolling power of social media, we don't have time to validate if a provocative photo that was just posted was taken 20 minutes ago or 2 years ago. And four, no one can keep up with the erratic public health messaging around COVID-19. We are caught in a wave of decision fatigue from the hundreds of choices we must make related to our health each day. Moreover, we have been forced to make most of these decisions, decisions about our COVID-19 protocols, on our own. This creates a dynamic in which everyone is looking out for themselves and the information that is the most persuasive to them. It seems like there is no alternative. And yet, I sense that no one wants to be sick, poor, or angry. Everyone, my sense, wants to live happy and meaningful lives. But how can we do so if we can't agree on our basic reality? This is where the study of rhetoric can be helpful. Many of us think of rhetoric as bad or empty speech, or, let's face it, political garbage that people say instead of useful content. Aristotle and others have defined rhetoric as the available means of persuasion, the possible ways that we can persuade someone to do something. But the definition of rhetoric that I find to be the most useful comes from Dr. Patricia Roberts Miller, an eminent scholar in the field. She writes, as I note on this slide, that rhetoric is the study of potential misunderstandings. She explains further, rhetoric doesn't help you avoid disagreements, because a world without disagreements would be a bad thing. Disagreements result from lots of things, many of them good, such as different experiences, perspectives, and areas of expertise. None of us knows everything, so we can learn from one another. Thus, good disagreement leads to better public decisions because they are more broadly informed. So we shouldn't avoid disagreements, even highly conflictual and emotional ones, but we should try to make them beneficial. But what do we do when disagreements seem unavoidable and even harmful? What about times when so-called constructive conflict is not, in a word, constructive at all? And in terms of the COVID-19 pandemic specifically, many questions remain. How do patients find reliable health information when the recommendations are constantly changing? As well as, how do patients distinguish between innovative healthcare hacks and misinformation? I wish I had definitive answers to these questions. What I do know, however, is that we can take cues from people who had been sick with ambiguous chronic health conditions, people who were abandoned by doctors and scholars and forced to become their own researchers long before the COVID-19 pandemic. Specifically, my research on the rhetoric of Lyme disease offers insights into strategies we can use when we feel like we've lost our way. We can also take cues from the growing population of individuals with long COVID, which I will discuss in greater detail shortly. Lyme disease has become a topic of scientific interest and great debate because increasing numbers of people are getting infected, but they are not getting better. Long before most of us started questioning the CDC, or even knew what the CDC stood for, Lyme disease patients and advocates were protesting their data collection methods and diagnostic criteria, and perhaps rightfully so. On this slide, you can see a partial list of the many Facebook groups where people have gathered virtually for years to figure out how to move forward. Through years of research on the rhetoric of Lyme disease, including interviews with Lyme disease patients, studies of print and digital materials, as well as social media, I found that Lyme disease patients have developed three primary techniques for sorting and evaluating health information. First, reading selectively. Second, developing self-tests to evaluate their disease progression. And third, forming social networks for sharing information. Sick people don't have enough time, brain power, or patience to read everything. None of us do, frankly. They also can't access most academic journal articles, which tend to be locked behind university and journal paywalls. As such, Lyme disease patients are forced to skim social media posts, blogs, articles available to them, books, and more in search of data that reflects their illness experiences. They test themselves to see how they are doing. Can I run a mile in a certain amount of time? Do I have enough energy to spend with my grandchildren? Can I get through my day without taking more than one nap? And at times, they try risky and dangerous treatments because they feel like they have no other option. stinging themselves with bees or bee venom therapy, taking intravenous antibiotics that have not been substantiated by research, drinking hydrogen peroxide, and more. On this slide, you can see a screenshot of the CDC press release from 2013, which revealed that the rate of Lyme disease diagnosis was more than 10 times what the CDC originally believed, 300,000 people per year instead of 30,000 per year were acquiring Lyme disease. Although the CDC has long studied the rate of Lyme disease infection, this revelation suggested that their data collection methods were flawed. Over the years, patients continue to be forced to become experts in order to access a broader range of diagnostic tools and treatments. Are these healthcare hacks, or are they potential sources of misinformation? My interviewees have mentioned that they've read in search of detailed discussions, seeking to find information about people who have had personal experiences and very similar symptoms. And yet, clearly, experimenting with risky, unvalidated treatments like these remains very, very problematic. COVID-19 itself already has developed notable sub-areas of contention, particularly around what is now called long COVID. Long COVID is defined sort of in two ways. First, as the persistence of initial COVID-19 symptoms, or the emergence of new symptoms caused by COVID-19 that don't seem to go away. People are getting and remaining ill faster than research about this cause is being published. As such, people with long COVID are forced to fend for themselves, studying user-generated content on social media sites such as Reddit, rather than relying on research or the support of healthcare providers for relief. Long COVID patients are forced to be on the front lines of research. On this slide, I've included screen captures of just three of the many long COVID organizations and research advocacy groups: the Survivor Corps, COVID Black, and the many long COVID subreddits. Worst of all, misinformation about COVID has harmed sick people. Interviewees from my latest study revealed that, in their opinion, one of the greatest sources of misinformation about COVID-19 is that it does not have long-term effects. These people are fighting for their lives, and sometimes doctors are denying that they are ill in the first place. To add to this burden, COVID-19 infections are now known to cause mental health problems, even in cases where people did not experience similar problems previously. Between persuading doctors that their symptoms are real and trying to find a solution themselves, long COVID patients, who are often called COVID long haulers, have also proven that they are ready to do the work of research. In some cases, these patients are receiving formal credit for their work. And as you can see on this slide, these are two of the many articles that rely on crowdsourced information. So what does all of this mean? A trending hashtag on Twitter, NEIS, meaning no end in sight, says it all. This hashtag is used by chronically ill people who are not sure what to do next. Again, I don't think that there's a simple answer to this question, but I do think it's crucial for us to consider what and who we find persuasive in our everyday lives. Consider this brief example. A few weeks ago, my husband and I planned to meet my cousin for dinner in Gainesville, Florida. We looked to Yelp to find a barbecue restaurant, as I am a North Carolina vinegar-style barbecue aficionado. The language of this review that I have added here for your review was so funny and memorable that we ended our search immediately. However, we didn't know anything about this particular Yelp reviewer. We had no proof that he was a barbecue aficionado or even that his tastes were similar to ours. It was almost like we didn't consider anything else because the review was funny. For the purposes of this presentation, I looked up his profile. Clearly, he was an elite reviewer last year and has many reviews. And you can see that I've anonymized his name and photo to ensure privacy. Yet in all, it seems like we're looking for people like us, people who are suffering like us, for answers. This problem is amplified when it comes to seeking healthcare information. Deciding who to trust is a daily, if not hourly, decision, and we must make these decisions arbitrarily. So whether you're researching barbecue restaurants or health information, I recommend the following. Keep reading, keep coding, meaning keep track of the work that you're doing, look across these different sources for patterns, and reflect. Just because someone is a doctor or well-known in a community doesn't necessarily mean that they're the expert authority on that topic. Thank you.
Is it working?
I'm late, so I have no idea what's going on. I apologize to the organizers. My name is Elena Cyrus. I am an assistant professor in the College of Medicine in the Department of Population Health Sciences. There we are. So happy Friday, everyone. We made it. I see these Fridays more as a sense of accomplishment, more now than anything else, especially for my life in the past 2 years. As I mentioned, I am an assistant professor, but what I really am is an infectious disease epidemiologist. I'm a global infectious disease epidemiologist that has been studying epidemics and has been an epidemiologist for over 20 years, remarkably. And I sit in population health sciences in the College of Medicine. And so just to differentiate that, as some of my esteemed colleagues here who are already in medicine, you know, medicine is the investigation of ill health at the individual level, so we have patients, and epidemiologists study things at a more broader scale, so we study things at the population level. So ill health in communities, in countries, in states, that's essentially what an epidemiologist does. Okay, so today what I'm going to attempt to do is sort of encapsulate, I have to say, first of all, thank you to the organizers for inviting me. It's a very fresh perspective. I've spent 2 years in data meetings, in task force, and so there is a very social aspect of this virus, of this epidemic, as there is with every pandemic that we enter into. As background for me, I started doing this type of work when HIV became an issue in the late 90s and the early 2000s. And for me to train as an epidemiologist, I had to leave the United States because we never really thought of things such as emerging pathogens to be a real threat or risk in this country. And so I worked for most of my life until the last 2 years. I worked in sub-Saharan Africa and in Latin America and the Caribbean region. I never really thought, and I don't think Dr. Fauci ever thought, that we would see something at this scale in this country, because we have, for the most part, as most Western countries, a fairly robust public health system until now. So what I'm going to try to do today is basically encapsulate everything that's happened in the past 2 years, where we are now, and you know, maybe sort of guess where we're going in the future as we move towards endemic status, and then take any questions that there may be. I'm sure there will be a lot. I have a lot of questions myself too, actually, so maybe we can help each other. So COVID-19 emerged late 2019, as we've already suggested. It was a zoonotic infection, so it was something that jumped from animal species into human species, we believe, in China. And from there, we started to see a great spread. We see spread now quicker than we see in previous epidemics, because we have way more travel, immigration, and movement in general. So by January, it was fairly quick for the WHO to establish this as an emergency, as a public health emergency at the global level. And I will talk a little bit about the role of the WHO, the CDC, and the NIH later on in this lecture. But for right then, you know, once WHO declared it as an emergency, it was on guard time for all epidemiologists like myself. I am in a global health chat, and I remember that chat just lighting up and going on fire between December and February, and everyone sort of being coalesced. There aren't that many epidemiologists, as you could imagine, in this country. One of them is here with me, my postdoc, Dr. Kudre, and there aren't many in the world. When I first started doing epidemiology, people used to ask me if I was a dermatologist. There was such an, you know, it was such an unknown thing. And so, you know, from there, we've seen several waves. The waves have occurred faster. The waves are attributed either to, again, social activity or the emergence of a new variant. There have been several variants, but the three most dominant ones that have been most common in the media are, of course, Delta, Omicron, the original one that came out with, and there is a suspicion of another fourth variant, well, not a fourth variant, but a fourth wave that is attributed to a new variant that's now emerging through Europe and also in Southeast Asia. I'm just going to revisit, you know, so I get a lot of questions about what is the difference between a pandemic, an epidemic, and an endemic, and she did a great job describing it. But for me, so in a past life of mine, I actually used to study literature. And so if you just look at the roots of these words, sometimes you could kind of figure things out. Demos just means belonging to the people, of the people. So every single word that you see with demos automatically reflects into population level things. And then if you look at the prefix of each of these words, it will intuitively tell you what these things are. So an epidemic, like an epicenter, that is a disease that has outbroken in a specific locality, right? Once it begins to go across borders, and there's not really any clear definition of this, but really once it is in a number of countries or a number of states, then we move beyond what we consider an epidemic, and now it's a pandemic. Endemia is, or something that's endemic, again, en, the Latin root, means in or within. So now you're living with that disease. It's a constant present. It sounds scarier than it is. We actually live with a number of viruses, bacterias. We promote now, we've gone so far in germ theory that we're actually reversing and saying that it's beneficial to our immune systems to have some level of microbiome shock. And so, you know, what we want is to always live in harmony with these viruses without it being a threat to us, to our survival, right? That's essentially what we mean by endemic status. And these are just some random examples that we pulled together to give you an idea of what an epidemic is versus a pandemic versus endemic. So the HIV actually was one of the last pandemics. As I mentioned, that was how I was able to train, and that was something that impacted every single continent. No one was spared with that. And then an epidemic, so the difference between an epidemic and a pandemic is with an epidemic, we know what to do to treat that disease. So we have had enough time, we have enough body of research, we have enough medical advancements that if someone were to have yellow fever, if they were to have dengue fever, we have the capacity to save that person. When we have an emerging epidemic, such as coronavirus, right now, in this today's date, this Friday, it's not a threat to anyone here in this room. But 2 years ago, when it first emerged and we knew nothing, it was a massive threat. And it wasn't a threat so much to our human person, it was a threat to the health systems. What happened was that if you have such a scale, if you have so many cases of something that you don't understand and you don't have a lot of time to figure that out, the health system can become overwhelmed and then it becomes ineffective. And so, you know, all of the things that we did before that were, you know, beneficial in the past, now it sort of falls flat. So what we've done in the past 2 years is caught up to where the virus is and where our science is that we can actually respond in an effective manner. And then some examples of what we live with that's endemic is the common flu, you know, conjunctivitis, and we expect eventually that coronavirus will get there. I would even hesitate to estimate that there's probably a certain number of people in this room right now that have coronavirus and don't know. You're probably asymptomatic. And that's where we're leading to, that's what we're going towards. But the issue for most diseases that become endemic is, and I'll talk about this as we move through the lecture, is that there are certain populations that remain at increased risk. So the general population might do well, but then you'll have a small group of people. They may be immunocompromised, they may have cancer, they may have HIV, any number of reasons. That group of people now, they don't have the same level of protection that we all may have, that we can sit here and have asymptomatic COVID and not really worry about it, right? So that's kind of where we are right now with COVID-19. This is just a plug to please beg people to stop using things that the CDC does not recommend. It's not helpful to you. You may think that you are seeing some immediate improvement, but often it's psychosomatic and it's short-lived, and it might lead to other complications that we really won't be able to help you with at that point. Coronavirus is that. It's a virus. So it can only be treated with antivirals. It cannot be treated with ivermectin. Ivermectin is an antiparasitic, so it can help you with lice. It can help you with certain dermatological conditions, but it cannot help you with a virus. Similarly, we can't do anything with antibacterials. So, my mother's Trinidadian, and I spent a lot of time in the developing world, and we'll treat anything with antibiotics, okay? If you have, you bump your head, antibiotics, there it goes. But this is leading to a huge problem, which could be a whole other lecture. And so it's sort of begging people to, to help us and just do what is prescribed for viruses. There are currently two approved antivirals. One is through Pfizer, one is through Merck. Now, admittedly, I know some people are looking at me in pure confusion. A lot of people don't know about it because it's still in production. Right now, we don't have many clinics, we don't have many sites that offer these antivirals, but we do have a promise from the federal level. It was announced in the White House plan, which was probably the first time that all of us ever found out about it, that they're moving towards something called the Test and Treat Program. So that as soon as you have the virus, or you detect the virus in your bloodstream, within 5 days, you can get one of these antivirals, and it will minimize your symptoms and minimize your possibility of being hospitalized or even death in some cases. So keep an eye out for those things. They should be available. I'm not going to say when I think they should be available, but they should be available fairly soon. What is the risk of a new variant? Very, very likely. There's probably variants among us all now. But don't worry, because the way that a virus works is that it attenuates. It gets weaker over time. So every year with the flu virus, we have new variants. With HPV, we always have new variants. We're always expanding, right? But the virus, they have the head start when they first emerge because they catch us off guard. But once we understand that virus, we can deal with it appropriately, right? So the severity goes down, it attenuates, we get accustomed to it, it acclimates to us. Plus we have treatment, plus we have prevention methods. So don't be alarmed when you hear all the other new viruses that come about. It's okay, we can handle it as long as we follow guidance that come through as the research evolves. Wait, sorry, I feel like I missed something there. Oh, yes. So I just wanted to state here now that the reason that we think we're at endemic status and that we should maintain that endemic status unless something out of the ordinary occurs, which these days is also quite likely, but it's because the majority of our population we now believe has immunity, either through natural immunity because you've been previously infected, or through the vaccination, or through a hybrid of those two. What is unknown, which is why we still practice some level of caution and some people wear masks, is the duration of those things. Every individual operates differently. So some people may have up to 6 months, may have up to 12 months protection with one of those things, but the hybrid of both of those things. And some people, their immune system will act differently, so it may be less. Until we have more research that really understands the mechanisms of this protection, for right now, what we know, I think the most recent study that just came out for the third booster is that we know up to 3 months you have your maximum level of protection. Within 6 months, you should be fine. After that 6 months, you'll start to see it level off a bit, right? There's already some consideration for a fourth booster. Some countries have already implemented it, and some populations here in the US have already received it, depending on their level of risk and under their provider's guidance. So where we are for COVID in Florida is pretty much where the rest of the country is, with the exception of some pockets. We have had four waves. So the first two bumps May I stand or will it bother the camera? I can, okay. Okay, so these first two bumps here, this is really the emergence. And then we couldn't figure out what to do in terms of masking. You remember we would relax the policies a bit. We would unmask, especially around spring break. So when we saw that relaxation, so this is not a new variant. This is sort of like us testing the waters, right? So that's where we saw that here. And then we got a hang of things. We were like, okay, everything's fine. Boom, Delta. This was India, so we get Delta here. We see an emergence here. But Delta was not as communicative. So as bad as we thought this was, this is Omicron, right? Omicron was very scary. The scale was unbelievable. But we had South Africa that was ahead of us, and we saw how fast that wave went up and down. So we were hopeful, but we weren't sure because, again, these social contexts are different, and they have a very large impact on the behavior and the pattern of the disease. In terms of vaccination, so, you know, across the board, we're fine in terms of vaccination levels. Miami-Dade County is at 95%. Actually, in Miami-Dade County, in some places, they're over 100%, which is wrong. And this is another problem with the data collection. We have huge problems with surveillance. I'll admit it. I'm a data scientist. I won't lie to you about anything in this lecture. I've been caught too many times. So, you know, what's happening in Miami-Dade is the level of immigrants. So we have many people coming in from Latin American, Caribbean region, Eastern Europe. And so they come in, they get vaccinated. That goes into our surveillance system as part of Miami-Dade. And then you get to these high levels. So this might be an overestimate. And then here, you know, in general, we might be seeing more accurate levels. So while Florida is, you know, relatively good and we can feel safe, where we are right now and what I actually have grants from NIH to look at is that there are certain populations that are disproportionately affected. Obviously, race and ethnicity seems to be a huge issue. So Latinx populations, African-American populations. As a disparity researcher myself, these are not things that are surprising to me. These are disparities that we see pretty much in every disease, whether it's from HIV to sickle cell to sexually transmitted diseases. But what is concerning to me, so I always follow data. I don't follow any personal interest, is that the issue of Native American populations is very concerning. It was interesting to me when you brought up the Intuit example and how collaborative they were with the government, because now they won't let anybody near their anything reservation. So actually, in 2 weeks, I have to fly to Arkansas to get data for Native Americans because I can't get access in Florida at all. They won't let me in. And I think this speaks to the level of distrust that has now, you know, there's a big divide between the community, the scientific community, and also the policy and the regulators. And this really works to our disadvantage because it's only with the synergy that we can sort of, you know, make any advances, make any progress. I will say that, you know, in my lifetime doing this type of work with COVID, it's the first time that I had ever seen governments operate in that manner. Up until that time, if I ran a study in India, I had to get 5 levels of approval from 5 different ethics committees. It would take me 2 to 3 years to step into the country. With COVID-19, immediately, everyone just came together, and that was a huge boost. But now that everything is sort of settling down, you see the segregation occurring again. You see the lack of collaboration between industry, between government, and this is only going to harm us, really, in the long run. The other issue that we have is long-haul COVID. This is a huge issue for us because COVID-19 is different from most respiratory viruses in the sense that it's a multi-organ. So for upper respiratory viruses, you hit the lungs, you know, these obvious areas, but we're seeing some effect in the brain as well as some other organs. We don't understand what's going on. We don't know what's going on. And then some of these symptoms that occur, they're not probable, right? So we have, at this point, been stuck in investigating the acute phases of COVID-19. That was what was necessary in the past 2 years. We don't have the resources to move into long-haul COVID, which is why we are begging everyone, please, to just bear with us for a little bit longer until we can get a handle on the research for long-haul COVID so we understand the risks, we understand who is at risk, Who needs to be protected? Because I will tell you honestly, it's an unknown. We see things like higher cases of maternal mortality. We think it's related, we are not sure. More infant mortality, that's an unknown thing for the United States or for many countries. This is a little bit scary, right? So while the numbers are low, it's still of concern and something that we need to figure out. We've already discussed long-haul COVID, and I don't want to keep everyone here past lunch, but essentially, you know, it's they've called it post-COVID. They have no clear clinical definition for something. That's always bad when you don't have a clinical definition for something. They think it could be 4 to 6 weeks, maybe longer. It's really sort of loose right now, and I hope that the research will flow from that. So talking about flow of correct information. I know that everyone is confused. There's a lot of things going on. There's the WHO, the NIH, the CDC, Zuckerberg, Gates, all of them, right? Everybody's an epidemiologist now, but it's not hard. It's almost like a level of common sense mixed with what do you think your individual risk is? This is not a uniform science. There is not going to be, there are some people here without masks, there are some with. The people who have masks, they know why they are wearing masks. The people without, they understand why they're not wearing it, right? We have to now trust every single person at the individual level to make these decisions to keep our communities safe. Florida is different from the rest of the country because DeSantis has declared us a free state, meaning that we have complete autonomy over what we want to do, but it places a huge amount of trust at the community level to protect individuals. We have to trust that when we walk into the 7-Eleven, if you don't have a mask, you're fully vaccinated without COVID-19, you know, and many other conditions to feel safe, right? So just to help you a bit, I'm going to try to describe what all of these agencies are, and then you can ask me another time what they are. So WHO, they are basically a figurehead. They're like the queen of public health. They have no regulatory power. They are not a government. They're policy. They are a centralized entity where all of the governments can come together. So it's like the UN of public health, where all the governments can come together and we can have all of our information in one place. It's just a place for us to centralize and where they send out the recommendations. Within the WHO, right, then all the different countries, they participate as part of that WHO. So the United States, Canada, whomever. Each country has their own public health system. So they can take all the advice, and you'll see it. You'll see the differences in how countries apply the WHO recommendations. China has a very high no-tolerance COVID-19 policy. You can't do anything around there with suspicion of COVID lockdown, okay? Florida is very different. So there's a wide, level of interpretation of the WHO recommendations. And that's for each prime minister or president or chancellor or whomever to decide what is important for their country, what makes sense for their country, right? How much immigration exists, all of those things. So for us, what we have, our health system, it's called the Department of Human and Health Services, DHHS. And there's a Secretary of Human and Health Services. And then underneath the secretary, they establish departments of health for each state, right? Okay, I'll stop there for you to, wait, let me just go back and show you that under HHS, then you have the FDA, you have HRSA, you have NIH, you have CDC, and you have SAMHSA. So none of these people, the FDA doesn't control the CDC doesn't control NIH, none of it. They all operate with different roles under HHS, and I'll describe to you what some of those roles are. So NIH, again, not a policymaker. They have no power, they have no control. What NIH is essentially a massive research think tank. Within NIH, there are different centers, right? So there's a center for cancer, there's a center for infectious diseases, which is what Dr. Fauci leads. And because he was the director for that Institute of Infectious Diseases, COVID fell under him. So that's how he ended up, you know, being the most popular person in the media for some time. But the real director of NIH is not Anthony Fauci. It's a very nondescript man called Francis Collins, who I think is amazing. He has outlived like every administration that's come through Washington, D.C., which is a huge compliment. It's a tough thing to achieve. So he's gone through, this is Dr. Collins right here. He's actually also a philosopher, I think, and an ethicist to some extent. And then this is Dr. Fauci. So if you ever want to be mad at someone, it's not Fauci, it's Collins, because he's his boss, okay? let me see. Yeah. Then you have the CDC. And the CDC, again, this is going to be a comment, no power, no control. They're not policymakers. They're not regulators. The CDC, what they do is they take all the information from the NIH. So the NIH does all this research globally, everywhere, not just within the US. They go, because I've been funded through NIH to do research in all kinds of places. They take all that research from the NIH, feed it to the CDC, and then the CDC decides how, you know, it should be applied at certain levels. It's almost like the defense force for diseases in this country. There's a unit within CDC called the Epidemiology Intelligence Surveillance Unit, and they wear militia like they're part of the army, right? Because their job specifically is to protect all of us against pathogens, right? So that's what CDC does. And then the head of CDC is Walensky. And so again, what she says, okay, so Fauci comes to her and he says, I think X, Y, and Z. And she says, okay, I think 70% of what you said is true. I'll make it a wide announcement. You know, this will now become a PSA and this will be something that will be applied at the national level. So that's CDC in a nutshell. I'm really simplifying this. If anybody heard me doing any of this, I would probably get in trouble in some manner. And then under CDC now, the governor of each state appoints a surgeon general. For us in Florida, it's LADAPO. And so these are the ones now, these are the regulators. These are the ones that take the recommendations and they decide what is law in our states, in our communities, in our districts. And so for this reason, you will see that the mandates, which I'll talk a little bit about the mask mandates as well as the vaccine mandates, those are laws that are implemented at the state level for Florida, but those laws are very different from what's happening in California, from New York, from, you know, everything depends on what our governor says through the Florida Surgeon General. And running the ship of all those people is our illustrious leader, President Biden. And so he is essentially saying right now, about a month ago, he came up with something called the White House Plan, which was introduced during the State of Union. And what he's saying is, okay, I appreciate you, NIH, CDC, all of you, but these are the goals. This is what I want in the next 5 to 10 years. I want to achieve these 5 things, and I want you to do whatever you need to do to achieve these 5 things. Some of these things we are well on our way to doing. Some of them are in very nascent stages, some very early stages, but this is the overall goal for our nation, for our country with COVID-19. We want to ensure that all young children have access to vaccines. Where we are right now is that children under 5 have not been approved, and that is pending further regulatory approval, which I could get into at another time, but essentially, the trials are taking a little bit longer than we anticipated. So for children under 5, we thought that 2 doses would work, but it's not the case. We think that they need 3 doses. So now we have to study them at the 3-dose level to ensure that it's safe. We knew that it was safe at 2 doses. We didn't know if it was safe at 3. And so before we implement, we want to just make sure that it's fine. So ensure that Americans of all ages can get a vaccine. And if you read the subtext here, what they're talking about is disparities. So what they mean by all Americans of any age is that you shouldn't have higher access to a vaccine because you live in an affluent area that is predominantly non-Hispanic, white, for whatever reason. No matter if you're in a rural part of this country, if you are whatever age, you should have equitable access to that vaccine. So that's what that second bullet is meant to talk about. Increased manufacturing, I think, to over 1 billion, I think we've achieved this. We've saturated the market with vaccines, so that one, I would almost put a check mark there. Continue vaccination outreach and education efforts towards misinformation and disinformation. So within public health, we have many different arms of public health, and one of them is called health communications. And health communications is the marketing arm of public health. So that is essentially that bullet. We need people to do good marketing, essentially, with regards to the research that NIH is doing and how CDC is applying it so that it makes sense. And there, I think we are not doing that good of a job, but hopefully it will improve. And then ensure that there are enough treatments for Americans who need them, and this is with regards to the antivirals. So the treatments are specifically Paxlovid that came out from Pfizer and the other one that came out from Merck that I can never pronounce, but they're not enough of them. So that's what this point of this goal is. Non-pharmaceutical interventions is a fancy word for, or a fancy term for masking, social distancing, anything that doesn't require therapeutics. So anything that doesn't require a chemical intervention to some level. So what physical changes can I make in terms of reducing my risk? I get questions about this all the time. When should this be used? This is really at everyone's discretion now at this point, especially in the state of Florida. We have no laws, and we have nothing to enforce any of these things. But I would say for me, in general, if I'm in a room like this and I feel like the social distancing is adequate, I may consider taking my mask off. If I walk into a highly dense area, like a music festival, you know, that they have all over Florida, or Disney, or, you know, some enclosed space, I'm immediately putting my mask on. And the other thing is, another change for us is that when we used to think about crowding, we always thought about crowding and ethnic density in terms of increasing risk, especially for communicable diseases. But we always thought about it in terms of indoor crowding. And I think what we have learned from COVID-19 is that there's outdoor crowding, because when we released the, you know, the restrictions within Florida, we saw massive outdoor gatherings that led to, again, these little sub waves that you would see throughout. And it was all, we're actually conducting a study on this right now to look at network analysis and what happens when we have large gatherings with clusters of COVID outbreaks. So for this, I leave it to the individual at your discretion and knowing your level of risk. So where are we now? In this state, the management of COVID-19 has sort of shifted down to the individual level. So it's the burden is sort of upon the individual to decide, again, what non-pharmaceutical interventions they decide to use, how often they will screen, and screening is important, especially with regards to the use of antivirals, because the antivirals can only be used within 5 days. After 5 days, you can't receive it anymore. So if you're a person who considers themselves to be at increased risk and you really want to understand the level of virus in your bloodstream, you may be one of those people that consider routinely screening, maybe weekly, maybe every week, because you want to be able to catch that viral load at a point when it is treatable. After the 5 days, it's not treatable. We have monoclonal antibodies. This was effective with Omicron. It was effective with Delta, not so much with Omicron, and we don't know what will happen with new variants. So the allure of monoclonal antibodies has sort of diminished, because we understand that it's not something that could be uniformly applied and not something that can help us at a grander, a larger scale. And I've already spoken about the antivirals. There are certain things that are evolving. I know that the Aviation Association is meeting and in negotiations to discuss, not only for passengers, but also for employees of airlines, what will happen in terms of masking. So I think within the next 12 to 18 months, I'm being cut off, within the next 12 to 18 months, you'll start to see some changes with regards to policy. And I'm at the end. So this is, these are stuff that we're doing at UCF. in College of Medicine, outside of the College of Medicine. We just recently got money through Congress to do a preparedness, an epidemic preparedness center. So that's something that will be ongoing at UCF within the next 12 to 18 months. This is led by Dr. Parks and also Dr. Crowes. And this is a combination of medicine with hospitality, understanding that you can't just look at the virus without the social context. So we included hospitality because we were very interested to look at things like immigration and tourism, especially for Florida and how that impacted risk. We have our vaccination campaign. I'm working like crazy with Dr. Kudre. We have a new group, which is specifically for global health and infectious diseases. And so we're doing both epidemiological studies as well as intervention studies to look at impact for Latin America, Caribbean, as well as Florida. And then as far as I know, everyone is doing research across the university, not just medicine, not just public health, history, English, because it really is one of those dynamic topics, I think, that is multidisciplinary and needs, you know, it can't just be looked at in a silo of science. It needs to have the backing and support of the community, really, to be successful. And so these are just some people I encourage you to look at. Alvina Chu is our Director of Infectious Disease at the Orange County Department of Health. She's doing an amazing job. I came from Pop Health Sciences. Dr. Dykin is Student Health Services. Dr. Trapka is my mentor from FIU and also part of the COVID-19 state health force. I call her probably commonly to cry and complain. And then I work with NEMORS because we have some children studies going on looking at COVID-19 in children. And we also have another study from NIH looking at disparities. This is my email address in case I didn't address something that needed to be addressed. And thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you. Oops. Four fantastic presentations. We have about 20 minutes left. I think we'll proceed by taking questions from the room first, and then after that, questions that are virtual. So let's open up the floor. Do we have any questions for any of our presenters about any aspect of what they've said? We have a mic too, I believe.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay, maybe is it a question? Okay.
Yeah. Hello. I have a question for Dr. Foster about what you mentioned in your presentation on germ theory not being acknowledged by American physicians till the 20th century. I hope the question isn't too ambiguous, but could you expatiate on what led to American physicians taking germ theory more seriously?
My mic, there we go. It really was a matter of, there's actually some politics involved. The research was coming out of Europe, and there was a level of distrust of Americans, generally of Europeans. And so because it wasn't research done here, it was just something that was slowly developing. At the same time, there was a growing public distrust of physicians because as people were getting sick with things like cancer and more chronic diseases and dealing with occupational injuries, we're dealing with coal lung at that point. The lack of trust that was growing in Americans among the medical community was putting a lot of strain, so we had people turning to alternative medicine at the same time. So it was a level of frustration, I think, and again, it kind of got caught up in those emotional elements of it. So it was just something that evolved. It took about 20 years for American physicians to say that yes, this seemed to make sense. So it's really politics.
Oh, may I? I'd like to say also it's not uncommon. every time there's something that breaks the mold of a tradition or a norm, it usually, because you're flying in the face, science does something called peer review. So we all criticize each other. And we are a species that loves conformity. So whenever there is something that breaks that particular, because we're going against germ theory now, not going against, but we're sort of expanding upon our understanding of it and the application of it. And even that is something that is slow to be accepted and considered a new truth. So I don't think it's uncommon.
Yeah, that transition, we call it a paradigm shift. It really comes down to a critical mass of people finally buying on board, and then people slowly move over. And that's ultimately how science changes.
My question was for Dr. Foster as well. I hope I'm remembering this correctly, that Benjamin Rush, as he was treating yellow fever, had his patients drink mercury and discovered that he believed he saw some success from his patients drinking mercury, which of course was lethal to them down the road. And as I was listening to this wonderful convergence of disciplines, it made me wonder if you saw any parallels or what parallels you did see between the treatments for yellow fever and what we've experienced in epidemics through the years and now with COVID.
You see mercury used to treat a number of things for quite a while. And we know now it's toxic and it certainly shouldn't be using it for anything. But at the time, the vast majority of physicians were still working on the idea that disease ultimately was an imbalance of humors. So how do you rebalance the humors to something normal? And literally that was the understanding of yellow fever at the time. Even those who were of the contagion theory, it was still about balancing the humors. And that was the whole point of bleeding. But he also did prescribe emetics and laxatives. I mean, it was about bleeding and purging in a lot of ways. And ultimately his patients, I think, were as affected by dehydration and, you know, imbalances of electrolytes and all the other things that, you know, these patients are experiencing. So there was some a lot of disagreement in terms of treatment, and the patients that did better were not Rush's patients. They there was a French doctor, Dazer, I think, who actually came from Santo Domingo, and he was basically treating his patients with teas and you're rehydrating them, and they did better. So it was a misunderstanding of what these things would do. And honestly, if they were causing, you know, that purging, that was something that seemed to be a good thing, get those toxins out in a lot of ways. So yeah, it wouldn't surprise me if he was using mercury. He was definitely using some things that were not that pleasant.
Hi, everyone. First off, lovely, lovely job on each presentation. I had a question for Dr. Singer. Could crowdsourcing be a negative in terms of influencing distrust between the individuals and healthcare systems?
Thank you for that question. Regrettably, yes, I do think so. I mean, I think we're caught in this problem. And I'm writing a whole book about it. So, you know, it's really a big problem that we've got these, you know, sometimes the only data we have is this crowdsourced information. We're getting it in real time, but we also have the problems with crowdsourced information. It's not always right. People misattribute things. And there, of course, are people who occasionally there are people who just want to be sick or who are looking for attention. You know, or people who really have something else that's totally wrong, you know, and are just, you know, unfortunately, then sharing and amplifying these incorrect perspectives. So, yeah, unfortunately, I do. What I will say, though, is more than I've seen in the past, and certainly I would call upon the other experts on this panel, this patient data is becoming evidence used in peer-reviewed academic journals, which is kind of like the, you know, way experts communicate to other experts. And so that, to me, as a technical communication scholar, is really relevant, that this data is starting to become more meaningful, but certainly I would invite others to share.
Yeah, there was a recent conference called CROI, which is something for the opportunist infection. It's a big, big infectious disease conference. And one of the findings that came out from that conference is that they've seen the rate of literature for COVID-19, even, you know, comparing, I don't know how they do the adjustments for other previous periods, but this rate of publication is higher than anything that they've seen in their lifetimes. I can't remember the exact ratio, but it was something like 200 to 1 or something like that, because it includes not only traditional scholars, I guess people who are considered experts, but also lay community and some of these crowdsourcing things. They've also developed different mechanisms for publishing. So before, while a paper was in review, that data would be hidden from the public until it finished its process. Now we do something called preprint. So even while the paper is under review, the public has access to it so that it's not delayed. There's a big problem with delay in the translation of science. We call it bedside to practice. So there's a big delay in that translation. And I think that delay is speeding up. The problem is that the level of accuracy. So the other thing that we saw with COVID-19 was that as much as we saw this massive rate of publications, we also saw a huge rate of retractions. So there was this wide burst of publications with all this type of information. When they had the time to go back and check everything, they had to retract a good number of those papers. So, it's all evolving.
Yeah. There are also extraordinary, actually successful cases of crowdsourced medicine. So there's programs in which you have guided diagnostic, right? So in Yale, they do that. And you can actually get that to your advantage. It's just that you have to study structurally how to avoid echo chambers, how to bring together the information of the crowd so that it actually brings that output. So there are actually, it's not crowdsourcing in itself.
But the one problem with the algorithm-based, there's a new group called the Algorithm Justice League, because there's inherent bias within algorithms. Algorithms were built and developed. Machine learning was learned from white men. And so many of these algorithms are, so for example, when you look at an algorithm for CVs, an algorithm that has many more reference points of women tend to be ranked lower than its comparator. So there is an inherent bias with the machine learning as well. It lends to efficiency, but it also speaks to the powers that are in control. So I think everything comes with a little caveat.
Right.
Yeah.
So you would have to have data ethics in order to consider, right, if you're going to use algorithms. But you can do crowdsourcing without algorithms too. So this is where the academic community makes a partnership with the community at large in order to find those virtuous ways to collaborate.
Let's take one more question here from the audience, and then we'll switch to virtual.
Thanks. First, I'd like to thank all the speakers and the organizers for putting this together. I think it's been a nice presentation through the course of several diseases over the last 200 years, and we've addressed through different speakers different facets of science, social impacts, effects on different populations and minorities, and media. But one thing we seem to have overlooked, and maybe purposely, is the impact of politics. And so my question is to the panel, do you think that politics during the last administration or this one have been at times a confounder of our progress in handling this epidemic? And is there any precedence for looking at that during the earlier ones, yellow fever, Spanish flu, and learning from those lessons?
Question.
Well, I mean, during the yellow fever epidemic, the government left. George Washington went to Mount Vernon, Thomas Jefferson went to Monticello. I mean, basically the only guy who stayed was Alexander Hamilton, and he got yellow fever. I think at some level, people in government are still human. And while we look to them for guidance and examples, they're still human. And they don't know anything more about these diseases than the people who are studying them. They know less, and they're reliant on science to provide that information and be the mouthpiece for that. And then there's already such divisiveness in politics, and that was no different in 1793. I mean, God, the election of 1800 was nasty. It's a problem. It's a challenge.
Politics is always a problem. I've lived through several administrations. I'm a scientist, I'm apolitical. It doesn't matter to me, really. Their overall mission is very different from my mission. You know, they have a broader mission to protect the entire country, economics, things that are outside of my purview. So how I've always operated, you know, whether it's the prior administration, this administration, and administration 3 to 4 years ago, I understand the rules of that administration and then I work within them. It will always have impact, you know, no matter what. There's no way of getting around it. It's like a parent, you know. You grow up in a house, the parent's job is to keep you safe. They have maybe a more antiquated point of view sometimes. Scientists are trying to push things forward, right? They're disruptors to a certain extent. And the government is not always supportive of that. So I don't know that any administration is worse or better than the other. There are pros and cons to each. It's a system that we live to work within it.
Okay, thank you. Couple of virtual questions, maybe?
Yeah, we have a few questions online. The most popular one at the moment is for everybody. And that is, why do you think that long COVID has played such a minor role in public messaging? If the public had realized that there was a chance that they could be left permanently disabled, do you think there would be more consensus across the political spectrum about taking COVID seriously?
No.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I mean, I can draw it back to fear. You know, this was such an unknown. And I think there is very much a reaction to want to ignore it, to pretend it's not there. The idea that this could be, you might be the one person out of 100 who is going to experience this for years or decades, be permanently disabled by it, no.
I was going to say, you know, my example with Odysseus, you know, enchaining himself to the master, because it's so hard to believe or to update your beliefs in ways that are credible for navigating a pandemic. So you don't want to know some things there. Sometimes the challenge is too hard in many levels, right? So I think that's the kind of a counterintuitive threat to the constitution of the person. So that's why I'm not sure more fear or less fear. It looks like you actually have to understand prudence as a behavior to navigate a pandemic and then work from there, perhaps.
I cannot speak to the psychology of the population and what they're open to receiving and not receiving, but I can tell you from this side, we have no data. It's very simple. We can't provide information. We barely know anything about the original virus, far less for long-haul COVID. So until there is data, there is really not much to offer except for try not to get infected. I think that's one of the reasons that we are so place so much emphasis on avoiding primary infection, an initial infection, because once that virus enters into your body, you know, we have less control than before. And the reason that there is no data is because there has been a drain on the health system. We have been overwhelmed and inundated by a number of global emergencies within health, outside of health. There's a limited and finite number of resources that can be applied. And right now, we don't have what we need to, we just had a huge redirection of money into defense that's going to have an impact on science and development. So nothing happens independently. Right now, we don't have data.
And so too, people want to think of themselves as a healthy person. You know, when we think about, you know, the way we conceptualize disability in American society, often it's shameful, it's very personal, we would consider it a medical model, meaning that a condition, you know, or some sort of illness has disabled someone, versus a social model, which would suggest that people are disabled by their environment. You know, when we don't have accessible, accessible doors and railways, and when we, you know, block people out of certain spaces physically, that is, you know, what is most impactful. And so, there have been, you know, people with ambiguous chronic conditions for years, and they face two problems of many. One is, depending on whether or not you have insurance, maybe there's a diagnosed condition, maybe there's not. You know, and so too, you know, we have such, you know, these poor healthcare providers who have been so strained during this pandemic. They don't have time to hear about all of your constellation of unusual symptoms, you know. Everyone is hoping that we have a simple health problem and can just move forward. So I would say, from my perspective, it has caused this sort of recursive or circular cycle of people looking elsewhere for information, but certainly I would not blame, you know, any one entity in particular. This is regrettably just part of the cycle.
Just a few more minutes left. Maybe take one more question from the virtual.
Yeah, this one is by far the most popular one, directed directly at Dr. Singer, but I assume everybody might have something to say. How do you recommend having constructive conversations with people who have varying or alternative beliefs regarding the pandemic?
Don't. I just think, you know, from as a scholar of persuasion, I have worked to try to persuade people in my family. And honestly, some of the most challenging people, they're watching right now, my own parents, who I would say their views on COVID, generally speaking, align with mine. So that it's not so much about people who are on opposite ends of the spectrum, but people who appear to have similar perspectives with slightly different interpretations. We just had some contention. They were coming to visit me, and I asked that they not dine indoors before they do so. I found out that they had. I insisted that one of them get a rapid COVID test. So it's not even, I would say, people on opposite ends. I think we're all every day trying to figure out our own risk, as we've been talking about here. So I wish I had some good advice for you, besides to create conversation cards for holidays and events about appropriate topics, art, music, theater, thus the value of the humanities, among other things. And certainly I invite others to join as well. I hope someone has better advice.
I have none. I'm sitting here just grasping onto anything that you have to offer me. Yeah.
I mean, it's very unfortunate, because I think during these times we need our networks more than ever, especially as our healthcare systems are strained. We can't necessarily rely on, you know, experts to help us. We need our families, we need friends, we need our friend families. And so when people have these varying perspectives, it makes it hard to communicate. It makes it hard for us to help each other. So, you know, and one challenge can be sometimes people, you know, we sort of demonize or really admire a certain person, and that shapes our entire understanding of a topic, whether it's politics or illness. You know, I have people in my family who they would just worship Dr. Fauci, and other people who think he is responsible for the scamdemic. So I think trying to also help people move away from, you know, sort of individualizing the problems that they're having. And, you know, trying to look for things that we do have in common. Hopefully we all want to be healthy and well. We want people to be safe. And we want to have really enjoyable holiday celebrations that are safe. So I welcome other commentary as well.
I don't have any solution, but I could say that talking about talking is actually very interesting. So you can, you know, examine. So how do you think it should be approach to the topic? So let's just talk about talking and establishing what you could consider a safe space to interact, and see if you can make progress from there. It's like baby steps. in constructing dialogical, I mean, dialogue spaces. So if you can do that, maybe you can discuss a number of things.
I'm with Dr. Cyrus, I got nothing.
On that note, then, I want to thank our public health experts and also our healthcare workers for the last 2 years, wherever you might be. And I also want to have give a great round of applause to our four panelists for their fantastic papers. And this will conclude then our panel, The Global Pandemic of 2020-2022, Historical Contexts and Current Perspectives. Thank you for attending.